Our speaker is Rick Madden. He's currently a member of the Pembroke Conservation Commission, a 25-year organic gardening educator at the Marshfield Fair, and a four-time state champion gardening educator. But he's also known as Pembroke's own folk medicine man and New World alchemist. He's speaking today on Earth Box Planters and the North Atlantic Reforestation Initiative taking place in the Pembroke Box. Please welcome Rick.
Guess I could do better than that. So speaking of the North Atlantic Reforestation project, on Arbor Day, the 26th, 7th, and 8th, we have 1,000 trees that are going to be being planted on Quad 12 of the Water Department. We can look that up, it'll be online. Everybody's welcome to come out. We have the village coming. Last time we had the Barrett School for the Blind, Alan Keller School show, and those are the people I really, really enjoyed working with. Everybody else is welcome also. So that's an event that we've been getting trees that were cut on 2006 at the ballpark. And there were trees, both for those trees cut, just basic foresters, 3-for-1. So we're getting 1,000 trees this year. There were 2,700 trees cut in all. So this will be your, you know, every year project, or maybe twice a year project, to plant them on blocks around the town. North Atlantic Cedar Forest, if you don't know, was an intercoastal rainforest that started at the Canadian border, high up in Maine, and was like a ribbon of forest all the way down to the panhandle of Florida. It mediated the temperature. They grow as one tree. The roots buttress through each other, so they grow on minimal land, like in swamps on clay with 2 feet of soil. So they really become one unit. There can be 10,000 of them in a swamp. They're literally related to each other physically, so that if there's a blight, if there's a problem, the tree can draw on all of its trees. It has a big node at the bottom, loaded with microfungal rhizomes and air roots, so it can grow in these conditions of flood and loss, but almost no soil. They grow to 500 feet tall. They grow 350 to 500 years. They were our giant redwoods. England cut every single one of them out of here before we were even a country. That's how it went. So anywhere from a beanpole, a picket for a fence, a rail for a fence, a mast for a ship, lumber for ships, had multiple uses right down to the last cut when you cut all the suckers off and just kept cutting them. They just go away. They kind of lose all their strength. So there's not one mature tree left in Massachusetts. There's one that's about 150 years old. It's a, what they call a pasture pine. It's got all the tops busted out of it. So they didn't cut that one. This was a rainforest, a coastal rainforest with orchids and pitcher plants in it and many, many species of other plants that we don't know what's there because it's gone. But it's a an endeavor to bring them back. One of the greatest things they do is start a sphagnum moss bed that they grow in, and it's purification of water. I actually use sphagnum moss in dressings now for its absorbance. The Native American Indians used it for disposable diapers. You know, those were just pick it, pack it, and that you had it. So it's important to bring them back where we were a cranberry growing society basically in Pembroke. And we all know those are actually called chemical berries. A lot of our friends call them, they're good friends of mine. So the toxins that were placed on the bogs since the 30s on, they have found when they dig down through the layers of sand they put on the vines, that all the toxins are trapped in the first 1/2 inch of that peat bed. So if you want to stop toxins from moving out of the box and lock them up and not have to deal with them, it's a beautiful situation. And of course, they cool the weather down. They give oxygen 24/7 because they're evergreen. And one of my favorite trees. Come on Arbor Day and plant some trees with us.
What's the beautiful name of the tree?
North American White Cedar. There is a very long name for it, which I don't do those of the North American signs.
How many do you have?
And how many do you have?
We have 1,000, and we've already planted 1,300 something before.
Are you going to do the one on the corner?
I was trying to get at the rotary block, but we can't do that one. I planted a tree there, and I showed that they grow 5 times faster than any other place we planted them. But I have to go through the DEP, and we will be doing that. It's just going to take a while.
So which block are you going to do?
Block 12. It's at the back of Big Sandy. I think you would have a door, man.
Okay, sure. 27. Route 27?
No, that's Little Sandy.
Little Sandy, that's right.
So, you look on the map, it's the back of Big Sandy, the Pembroke Water Department, and it's the Gore Mountain.
Yeah.
You can look it right up, and we'll be there from 9 o'clock to 4 o'clock on Saturday and Sunday, and love to see people come out and plant a few trees.
Is that in the block?
Yes, it is. Yes, but it's the town side. It's the last block that runs into Big Sandy, the water supply. So we figured we lock that up. That is a peat bed. That block is a 97-foot deep peat bed. Some people wanted to dig it out and make a reservoir out of it. So figured by making it a forest, that would never happen. And it'll also safeguard Big Sandy for all that's worth. Hello. Tithiness there about Brockton in the water. Too many straws in the lake, you know.
Yeah, the great cedars were they originally these?
The little schoolhouse around the cedar swamp, schoolhouse that they have by the historical buildings, that's called Around the Cedar Swamp School. This whole area, everywhere you see a cranberry bog, all the way to the coast, along the North River, any wetlands you see in this town, around all the ponds, everything was North Atlantic cedars. Gone. Very important tree to put back. Especially it locks in toxins and creates a nice cold water recharge system, very slowly holds the water and lets it go in slow. So when you get a rain event, it won't just hit the box, hit the ditches, and run into the,
Does it keep the toxins under, or does it absorb the toxins?
No, we'll just keep the toxins under it, and they create layer of peat. So finally, just lock them up, and eventually, it'll go away. Most chemicals, given whatever their half-life is, do tend to break down.
What's under the peat? You said clay? What's under the peat?
This one is peat.
Lots of peat.
A lot of times they'll grow on floodplains that are just clay, and they'll be like 2 feet of soil, 3 feet of soil, and their roots are not round. They come out flat, and they cross each other, and they lock right together in these flat buttress roots, and they do a good job of not blowing over and securing the land. And you know, I mean, as far as lumber, they were the number one tree. Here are the oaks, and here are this, but cypress trees are the top one to go.
And where are we getting them from?
These are from New Jersey, so they're local. And instead of doing bare root, we have little 2x2x4 pots with 6-inch trees in them. They're 2-year-old trees. And I figured sometimes it's better to plant small with a root than get a bare root, because bare roots you have to take them when they want to give them to you. And then you have to say, okay, I'm going to keep them going until the event. These trees, you can vote for any event you want. I like the idea of memorial trees. Somebody dies, buy a bunch of them, go put them in. And if you get to look at some of the protections that you can put in these spars, a veteran memorial forest is the number one way to protect the forest you're putting in. In New York, there is it's a 50-acre plot that's a Korean National Veterans Forest. And there's a huge horseshoe around it of a gigantic dump. and they wanted those trees gone. Well, it's a big horseshoe around them. They tried everything, they couldn't buck it. So my opinion, if you want to do a forest, try to do a veteran memorial forest and be protected for life. I just looked at other case studies.
Don't we have a veterans memorial forest here in Pembroke?
Yeah, right on 27th.
Yes, we do. And that's a good thing because it protects it. And down where that goes into the wetlands, I think that'd be another good spot to do it. But right now, I'm trying to lock up Pembroke Box the best we can, since they were the most hazardous thing we had in this town for a long duration. There's a lot of litigation in this town, people suing, diseases, and leukemia, and all sorts of other things popping up around dogs. I'm glad they're gone.
Are cranberries non-native then?
Cranberries are native.
Yeah.
But they're small, and there's usually it's a higher edge of a bank they grow on, like
different variety.
Yeah, they'll grow on the sides of the cape on the roads. You'll see them.
Yeah.
And that's the upland cranberry.
Oh.
And when they took out the cedars, unfortunately, they brought in the European red maple, which is a single ecosystem tree. It secretes harsh chemicals through its leaves onto everything below it, so nothing else grows. And then you have, you know, it takes all the nutrients. It's a non-diversified structure. They don't make peat, and they're just good for firewood in 30 years. But the good thing about them is they grow on all the blocks that they try to let go feral. But you flood them for 2 weeks in bloom, dead. So when you're planting these trees, if the red maples start to take over, you can flood this section of the bog, let the trees grow. And then, still leaving habitat, the dead trees will still nest and move the habitat around just with water. So that's a rare thing that you get to do, because 99% of the bogs that are taken over by nature are the red, which is a curse.
Nature can't fix them, I mean, you waited long enough?
They outgrow everything, they secrete. They So if you get the cedars in, they will definitely take over, diversify. There are orchids that grow there, pitcher plants, stagnant moss beds, and that really mitigates the flow of water when it hits it, instead of running off into a ditch and going into the street and becoming runoff, it becomes a recharge. And since we're pumping so much water out of this area, we all walk through recharging.
What about when you're going to do the Pleasant Street parks?
As soon as we get these done, and
because you are
and everybody in this room starts tapping away that we want more. Well, then we need to put it there, because that will safeguard the water supply. Safeguard the water supply and turn it into a place that is cool, dark. Gives oxygen 24/7, and given time, we'll have a treetop blow up and we'll have an eagle nest in it. They prefer it. So it's a long process, but that's what garden clubs are for. You organize, you say, hey, there's these trees that are still left in the kitty, and I've had to be very stern and active, and thanks to Art. Edgerton has been able to move this project forward. It's been since 06 these trees have been over.
Wow. Oh, wow. It's a bad one. They owe you more.
Yes, they owe the forest. And the garden club.
The exact weekend that you're saying? I didn't get the date.
Arbor Day, the 26th and 27th. 9 in the morning till 4.
Is there any master plan for the town, or anybody thinking about writing a master plan to make sure this keeps going?
A garden club will do that.
Oh,
was rhetorical.
Yes, thank you to contribute, but how does the town do that? Whether it's for zoning or conservation?
I think if you wrote letters saying you'd love to participate in planting trees every year, I wouldn't want to say no to you. As a group, there's more power. And don't just ask, put it in writing. That's my opinion about dealing with any political situation. Put it in writing. Keep the copy.
So if we show on April 26th and 27th, it's going to be behind Big Sandy Pond, Bog 12, where the water department is?
Yes, there'll be signs and...
And what kind of equipment and how...
We'll provide all equipment, and we're trying to provide some nourishment and drinks. Talk to Dunkin' Donut Chet, but they're usually pretty good. And we'll bring waters, but basically it's show up. It doesn't take long. It's only a 2x2x4 little pot. It's bang a hole, stick it in, wheel it in.
Okay. And it's a family event?
It's a family event, and I've had, like we said, we have... When the village comes and does it, we have parents food for the blind. That year we were using seaweed with sea lice in it and the saute, and some of these people were very, very handicapped. They had handlers, and we had a big walkway put on. It was kind of like, what is Rick next coming here? He wants a big walkway. Well, when the village showed up with parents food for the blind, we were very happy to have their wide bridge on and be prepared for them. So we've had vets come, we've had families of vets come that lost loved ones that planted trees for them. We've had people come back with their families that made it through and plant trees, and they're kind of like their little group of trees, they GPS them, and they feel that, you know, they're bond to that piece of land.
And how many trees did you say?
1,000. They were wondering if we could plant 1,000 trees.
Yeah.
I did 1,000 with 3 people 2 years ago.
How long did it take?
3 days. All day. Sun up, sun down.
Yeah. Wow.
It's a passion, you know.
Yeah. Well, hopefully we'll, through the website and everything, and through the news, we get some number of people together.
Yes, and again, it's a family affair. It's anybody is welcome, and we're prepared for people with very harsh handicaps. We'll get them on. We have planks, wheelchairs. But the good thing about the Bear School for Blind, they have some very challenged individuals, and they were feeling the seaweed, smelling the tree, put their hand in, let the sea lice from the seaweed jump on them and stuff, and just tactile therapy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they had a great day.
Yeah.
I have a great day either way. Myself just getting it done. We've been after these trees for a while. And I'm not going to say it wouldn't have gotten planted without certain people, but it's been a haul to get. So we now kind of have got that momentum with the first set coming from us. And I'd like to plan this for every year, maybe even a fall planting as well. Should have loved to hear that.
So are they fast growers? Or, I mean, you said they can live for 500 years, but are they fast or slow growers as a tree?
They're fast for the nutrients that they grow in. Can be very lean. These blocks are pretty rich because they were like agricultural.
Yeah.
And the block at the rotary, that one's this tall, and the other ones are this tall. So that's why I want to do the rotary block. Plus, the largest predator, or the largest predation, is by the littlest predator. Who knows what a vole is?
Oh,
gnarly voles. I didn't like voles at all, okay? When I started doing stuff, because they'll just girdle a plant and that's it. But in Plymouth, they did 15,000 trees and they fenced it in, thinking, we fenced out the predators, the deer. Well, they fenced out the foxes and the coyotes. So the little voles ate about half in the first 2 years. So this bog has voles, and we've had some predation. Unfortunately, when I looked at the area at first, it had a lot of foot traffic. People walked their dogs. I had them start walking their dogs around the bog to scent it. away from the deer. But best of all, it had two sets. There were four of them, black races.
Snakes.
They were scared as a kid. Yeah. You go running through there, and all of a sudden, you're doing a high step like a chicken.
Yeah.
But they removed the barn, the building they were in. Then they went to a rock pile. They removed the rock pile. They went to a wood pile. They burnt the wood pile. So I don't see the snakes there anymore. So I've started to have a little more predation. So this year, we're going to plant them out further in a wetter area with less grasses to hide the bulls.
Let the foxes come.
Let the foxes come, exactly. Yeah. And the harrier hawk fish, you know, goes after them all the time. So, and the owls eat them through the snow. So we're good on that. But I really miss those two sets of big black races. They were the biggest ones I had ever seen in my life. Scary. And they love bulls. You could see their tracks right through where the bulls were. And yeah, they kept them pretty much on the run.
What about the turkeys? They told me turkeys eat snakes.
Turkeys eat ticks.
Ticks.
Ticks. Everybody should actually hatch out some turkeys.
We don't have to.
You should, what you do, though, then, is you take some corn and your most tick-infested areas where you, along your wood edge, sprinkle a little cut corn, and then leave a little trail to the neighbor's house the next day, and then the next neighbor's the next day, and just keep them going through your neighborhood. They eat more ticks than anything. The drumming, the display of the peacock. But they really are miraculous tick eaters. And that's a real good thing considering the ticks are. Who knows the right name of the tick?
Who knows what?
The right name of the tick. There's too many of them now.
Deer tick.
Would you all agree it's a deer tick?
No.
No, it's more, it's southern tick.
It's like 700 species.
Well, the tick that we have in this area is a snake, a rodent, and a bird tick. That's why it's so small. It has nothing to do with the deer other than it becomes a host because it's the only living animal that we didn't kill in the forest. If there were other animals, they'd be on that. So the deer get a very, you know, vilified name because it has nothing to do with the deer and its biology. You do know it's a weaponized virus?
It's a what?
It's a weaponized virus.
What?
Lyme disease, epicenter. 2 Mile Island, there was another, 2 miles below 2-3 Mile Island, there was another island. And it's gone. It had a bio facility on it. It's been ripped out of the ground. There's been a one-time offer to everybody that died for 20 years that got really sick and they didn't know how they were dying in Connecticut. That's some money. So the Freedom of Information Act came out, lobbied for by Russia and China. Thank you. To show that our government's not so good. You want this up, I'm not making this up. It's a weaponized virus. And it's in your backyard. I've had 15 contact with it, each one genetically a little different from the next one. I have three of what they call hostile varieties that raise epidemic at times. So, get some therapists. Because you have a weaponized virus running around your neighborhood. Brought to you by the federal government. Not a good thing, not beating them up, that's what it is, so beware that it's that bad. It's now mutating. I killed a girl in Plymouth 4 or 5 years ago, a 7-year-old, and now it's killing kids in the southern states. They have more breeding cycles, so it advances the tick faster. So what they bred, their virus is now mutated so many times that there's so many different Lyme diseases now.
What kind of virus did they?
It's a spirea. They took Rocky Mountain fever, spotted fever, and herpes, and bred them together. So it's a spirea.
So it's a parasite with the virus.
It goes into your back. You never get rid of it.
Wow.
I know we should never get rid of the poison.
You know, we're not going to be like this.
Well, there's not much you can do about it, but get turkeys and train. Don't dress like me if you're in the woods. But that's just, you know, that's what that means. You can Google it, go online. Everybody in Connecticut paid. They just can't buy a photo, they have to give the money back. So, they're not talking.
So why don't we make a vaccine?
It changes so fast, and all you can do is antibiotics. And
I don't
think we have a vaccine or not. That's a good question.
Well, I thought it was a big farm and not enough money in it. Until the pig spreads through the country and enough people get affected, then they will put their money into it.
It's not a pretty thing. The thing that bothers me is I'm fairly old, and it doesn't bother me in the reproduction thing not happening. But I worry about kids that, like seeing Duxbury, they get a nice cul-de-sac with, you know, conservation land. And dogs have had it three times. The kids have had it three times. The adults have had it two or three times. What's the long-term effect for those kids in their reproduction? And what does it mean long-term? It can't be good. So it's a pandemic. One thing I wanted to do, instead of just hunt the deer and kill them, was to get paintballs with the heart's medicine that kills the ticks.
Oh, yeah.
You can still bring your kid out on a hunt. Get the buck, get the tick poison on them, they mate, spreads it around, and kill the ticks.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
You know? Right now they have an apple machine, that they have apples that are slightly fermented. Deer, you know, every deer is an alcoholic, they're all Irish. And they go into it, they touch the apple, it sprays the back of their neck. And the kids made these machines in the Hanover Votech. And they work great. They made two of them.
Oh, yeah, that's not going to do it.
22.
Wow.
Sometimes you wonder why that would cease and stop. It's such a good practice. They should be moving them around every time.
They should go in a shock tank.
Yeah.
They should. That's what it means. That's exactly what it means. But enough about ticks, they're not going anywhere fast. Unless they get on you and get in your car, then they're driving anywhere. Any other questions about anything but ticks? What type of gardening do you like to do? Organic or non-organic?
Organic.
I like to hear that. Earth boxes that I do are based on my heritage. I'm first born from Scotland and Ireland, and they cut all the trees off, except for the rich people in the center of Ireland, in Scotland, and then they burnt all the peat. Then they were on bedrock around the coastal zones, and they're like, you can't grow anything on bedrock. So they took the seaweed, the saute, and the fish, and they rebuilt the land. And it's really, really productive way to garden. When I garden, I was crippled. I went 27 feet on concrete stairs when I was 30. Unfortunately, on a federal post office building, they forgot to have the right insurance. And then there was a super fund from Congress supposed to catch you. I missed it by 48 hours. Judge Gary was crying, good friend of mine. So I started gardening in the easiest way I could, which was the way Gramps did. Saute is the topping. So you have no weeds. You barely have to water. And it has sea lice in it that are eating the hay and peeing out nitrates and all sorts of little bioorganisms. So what I do is I get seaweed and salt hay. Say this is your lawn, or it's a scrubby oak, you know, patch, or even a forest with a few trees. Cut them down, burn them, spread out the potash, put a foot of salt hay over it, come back with a post hole digger and use it in reverse like a duckbill. And then use it the other way and fill up the pail. Then put a pail of seaweed in, put the dirt back, reach in and just pull a little piece up like spaghetti. And then plant it, bring the hay right around the plant, and water it twice, and then water it three more times during the drought of the summer. And all you do is pick and prune. There's no weeding, no fertilizer, no petrochemicals. You get 30 eggplants on one stem, each of them five times more nutritious with no petrochemical load. So the production rate is huge, because what happens with the seaweed, it's a gelatin ball. And seaweed alone gives you a perfect score of organic soil is 57. Seaweed gives you 54 to make a perfect soil. It lacks a little nitrogen, so you put the salté on, the little sea lice, like salt sea monkeys, they add all the nitrogen base. So you have a, have a hole in the ground, is the surface. You now have a ball of seaweed at the bottom, then the soil, then the layer of salté. So you put a tap root down right away into the ball of seaweed, which becomes like poo, basically, and it's all gelatin, so it just holds the moisture. And then on the surface, under the hay, there's a starfish-shaped root that takes place. So you have a good tap root, and then you have it locked in really well, so it grows a large scaffold. And a fruit tree will put on enough fruit to kill itself because they're pruned, but a plant really won't. So you got a 2-inch stalk on an eggplant and 30 eggplants on. I do it at Marshall Fair every year. Come along and take some lessons there. So every plant I do that to, except for seeds. Where I plant seeds, I put maybe 1.5 inches of half peat moss and half sand over top of that soil that I dug in that location because it has seeds. You plant your vegetable seeds, they sprout, bring in the salté again. And you take a garden hose and just stick it open right on the hay, and it just disappears.
When you say salté, what is that?
Salt marsh hay. When you go over the 3A bridge.
H-A what?
When you go over the 3A bridge.
Oh, okay, yes.
And you see those beautiful marshes of all green grass.
Yeah.
In the winter, the tide comes up with the ice and sits on them. The ice sits, then it freezes, then the tide comes up and it plucks off the hay. Every tide, plucks the hay off all winter. And on the inside of Hummer Rock, or the inside of a bay, it pushes up in hedgerows. And as long as you're not taking it off of the green and below the high tide line, it forms in strips. And I've been gathering it for all walk in my grandfather's footsteps since I was 5 in the same place. So I've never had any issues with it.
And it's, same with the seaweed, so you just gather the seaweed along.
I get the seaweed at low tide, at boat ramps.
Mm. Oh, okay, yeah.
Any boat ramp, low tide, get the seaweed. If you go to buy seaweed in a gallon of Neptune, it's half water and half seaweed, and it's like $45.
Mm. You cut it up?
Right.
You don't. You cut it up.
No obsessive compulsive disorder got me. You see nature going to tell you, except for last week when it dumped the trees over? If you listen to everything they want to teach you about gardening, you're going to be obsessive compulsive disorder gardening for the rest of your life. Get seaweed, salté, peat moss, and sand and water. That's it. Lime, potash, they're a plus. No tilling.
No tilling?
If I have a lawn that's all crabgrass, somebody wants me to retro it, I come in and put 6 inches. First I put the lime down, I taste the soil. I'm okay, I use lime. Potash. It won't kill you, you eat worse. You go to the store and poison every day from the vegetables. So I just smell it, taste it, boom, that's what Grandpa did and I taught. He taught me. So I come in, you mow the lawn, or not mow the lawn, you put 6 inches of salté on it, you put the peat moss, the potash, and the lime down first. Then you water it down with the seed in it. The green manure, the lawn under the topping, rots off and produces nitrogen. Nitrogen from the bottom, nitrogen kills the other stuff, but the seeds are ready to go. It's got a good 6-inch barrier. It grows a mat right across the top of all the weed seeds. All the only thing that comes through is a dandelion.
That's good.
No chemicals, no treatment, just a lawn on the lawn that forms a mat that smothers it and eats the nitrates that it creates when it dies. Simple. So people, again, get into this. We're cultured to make everything a lot of work. Not just work, but you've got to work to get the money to go to the hardware store to get the stuff that you need to do obsessive compulsive disorder gardening. So containers, I do the same thing. I put a little bit of seaweed, saute in the bottom just as a buffer zone, and then I put seaweed right up the top. I put the soil, which is peat moss and sand. Put the hay on the top, you plant it in a, I like to use lobster totes because you can slide them and two people can handle them. In 5 lobster totes, you can grow everything you need for a garden. Up on your deck where the deer don't get it. You know, in a good spot. So this container gardening, incredible when you use seaweed because it doesn't grow. Garden boxes, ledge boxes, all of them. You do the seaweed and the saute, and just water them.
What's the best place to get seaweed?
Any boat ramp.
Boat ramp?
Any boat ramp.
So with any kind of seaweed, there's
no? Yeah, you can use
the stringy kind.
Yeah, the stringy type. I like the rockweed, because when you go and get it in June, it has these big, like, they look like kind of duck feet. They're gone to seed. You break those and squish one onto you, it's the best skin moisturizer you will ever use in your life. It is so smooth and glistening, it's just so good for you.
How much of the actually
use? I usually use, like, depending on how big the garden is, but in an area the size of a tabletop, 2 of these, I use a gallon.
That's what we have. We have to figure out what to do with it. We've been burning the same place for years and years.
I burn wood. That's all I have for heat is wood. So I just burn good clean wood. And I get like probably 5 5-gallon buckets of it at least. And if I need more, the other thing, when you burn outdoors, put the fire out early and get that charcoal. Did you know that charcoal for its cubic size holds more nutrients on its surface than any other thing known to man. Mm-hmm. And it purifies and stops acidification. So you take your charcoal and you inoculate it in something like fish emulsion or rotten seaweed. I do a lot of emulsions with the seaweed, and it's got enough crabs in it and other snails and things that you get the actual nitrogen from that as well. But just inoculate your charcoal and mix it in the soil. It's a miracle. And all you gotta do is put your fire on it.
That's easy.
No. Any particular plants somebody has a hard time growing or can't grow and has tried? No gardener will ever admit to that. That's a long time.
I'm trying to grow pussy willows from sticks that I've got. They've got the white
catkins.
Roots. Well, they've got the catkins, but those are falling off, and now they've got the green leaves and the white roots. Where do I go?
So the white roots are in the water you put
yes.
in. You should never let them get more than puckered and just start to see little roots because they're very delicate. So you can do it just very delicately. Don't punch a hole and jam them in. Make a hole bigger than the roots. Put them in and put sand and peat moss. Okay. And just water them. I have a stick, and you don't even need to do anything but cut sticks and just put them in. That's the easiest thing to root those. Willows are amazing. If you have a toothache, cut a piece off and chew on it.
Yes.
Aspen.
Oh, really?
That's where it comes from, yes. Aspen comes from, first of all. All willows have aspen.
What's up with willows? They don't like to plant them anymore?
Who?
Willow trees, they're almost extinct. I've seen none.
Well,
oh, so that's why they don't.
Beside the sewer?
Yeah, the ones, so I know that. I know they go to the water. I know that. That's what I was told. Yeah,
sewer.
But is it a plant that's
not.
And it stinks, or if you don't like them anymore because you don't mix.
They do plant them in some gardens. The last one I saw was the South River Water Shed. Planted them at a little park in Marshall Center between CVS and whatever that new place is. That was the last time I saw them planted, and that was like 20, 15 years ago. I think people don't like to clean up after them. They're kind of a messy tree because they're designed to break off pieces instead of mold down and break.
Oh, that's true.
I actually have a friend that they planted one on a farm, and she has passed away, but she said, if Jack goes first, have you cut that tree down right away. I don't know if I can do that. No, we both of them. He loved the tree, she didn't like the tree. Well, the tree is still there, and Jack's alone.
Well, it was a harbinger of spring.
But that process for Pussy Willows worked the same on Rosa Sharon.
Why would you want to plant a non-native invasive species? Just because my town was like smart enough to plant them at the Herring Run Park, and I don't know why, other than it was for the 300th, and it was a spirited thing. The guy has all of these plants and wanted me to plant them everywhere, and I'm like, well, I don't plant non-native invasive species. Thank you.
They're over the property line.
Take them up by the roots and stomp them.
I've got some
babies
you
can get. So how do you get rid of bittersweet?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's worse.
Continually try.
The
roots, once you get them out, don't let them come back. Mowing is a good way. You know, if any tree you plant and a bird nests in it, sits in it, poops in it after eating them, they're there. I've seen many plants in my life, but that is the only plant that has a mentality of homicide. It will grow, the birds will come in some bushes with a nice tree, 40-foot tree, bushes around the base. They'll poop out the seeds, it will grow a bush. For 4 or 5 years, it'll grow a bush. Just a bush, no real long tentacles, just a bush. And then 1 year, it decides we've got enough strength, and it goes straight up beside the tree, all the way within 5 feet of the top, and then puts 7 wraps on that tree. It grows straight as an arrow, almost no leaves on this thing, and then wraps the top of the tree, umbrellas it and kills it. So that's a tree that actually knows its environment, knows the tree it's going to kill, saves up the energy to do so, and then has a full-out attack on the tree.
How about wisteria?
Wild wisteria?
Huh?
Wild wisteria.
Yes.
All wisterias are not bad if they're maintained and you cut the seed pods off. Because all you got to do is cut the seed pods off, and they'll be fine. I love wisteria. I think it's a wonderful, beautiful plant. I know there's one down in Plymouth that's got a trunk like this, and it's been maintained on the fence, and it's just so oriental looking. But you just have to take the seed pods off. If you have wisteria, it's easy to get rid of than bittersweet.
Oh, is it really?
Yeah, bittersweet's much more aggressive, and it seems to germinate 1,000 times faster than anything else.
I planted some angel trumpet last summer, but it hasn't really taken off yet. Does that take a couple years
to
establish?
It's an invasive species also.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Don't worry, it'll just tear your house apart. When your house has vines growing through it. Yeah, that one's known for destroying buildings.
Well, I have it near fences.
That's good. I mean, anything controlled, and again, you're worried about it, cut the seed pods off.
Okay.
I mean, it will go underground and really start going up, but if it's on a fence and you mow both sides of the fence, you're okay.
Okay.
My wisteria is 15 years, never bloomed.
It's a fallow. It's not, it's a wild plant. It wasn't gotten in the nursery.
Oh, really?
Yeah. The wild ones very rarely, and if they do bloom, you get 1 or 2 blooms on something the size of this room. But that was a fallow plant to begin with.
I
this nursery.
They lied.
I think not a lot of they normally have to bloom in like mature in 7 years and just keep blooming and blooming and blooming. Mm-hmm. And I love them. They're a beautiful plant.
Yeah.
And unlike Rosa Sharon. and this person that wanted to plant Rose of Sharon all over the town because they just grow in his garden everywhere and in his rose beds and in his bed and in the mulch. I don't know how many he planted, but I see them all over town. I think some around the complex over here, some around the complex over here. Just do this. All over the town, including the Veteran Memorial at the Herring Run, which I think they should be removed. Because they're right on a beautiful, pristine water, meadow, freshwater meadow that's one of a kind, one of the best in the state. Who has heard of the giant parsnip?
Oh, that's nasty.
Yeah,
that's really bad.
Throw hands.
Oh,
okay. Yeah. I thought we had to take it. I did a better job. Well, do it now. Wild parsnip, look it up. Hogweed, cowweed. It's an invasive parsnip from Asia. The roots the size of my leg. Unfortunately, you can eat the root, but foliage and the pollen, when it gets on you, when the sun hits it, it goes right through all the layers of your skin. You have blisters like apple, half an apple, half an orange, half a lime, torn, disfiguring, 18 months to heal in a burn center, and you lose all the UV on that skin area, so you just burn all the time. The Herring Run is loaded with it, down in the Herring Run Park. I had a company that was willing to come in and treat it with Roundup in a very limited application, and it was shot down by conservation. I took the lead on that project until I solved the problem, in my opinion. The guy was a very earthy guy. He's trying to get rid of bittersweet and this invasive species. We were trying to set a precedent for using Roundup very caringly in a wetland or near a brook. Now, the North River Commission, second only to the state, if the Green Police, second only to the state, the Green Police is powerful. They do cut and bob right on the edge of the river. With the 50-foot, you know, very critical habitat zone. If you don't use it to get rid of some species that are right on a riverbed area with the silt and the water and the fertilizer, it comes natural. It just takes a little. So, in some applications, I am not against herbicide. Very limited time, very limited place, but it has a place. And when some kid gets his face torn off, down the Merriman, well, then I guess we'll address it. Until now, just sitting there, I gave the lead away because I solved the problem. And
how did you solve it?
I had a company going to come in for nothing and remove it with herbicide, gingerly, delicately, and responsibly.
But it wasn't
for
all
free.
And it wasn't all that.
I think
the sun, of course, is sweet with doing all
the... Yes, there is. And it's going to go down the road for each way. It actually started on High Street in Marshall at the old dump, which is about 200 feet from 3A, downhill. It migrated down 3A to Scituate and Hingham, then it migrated over to Humrock, and it's migrated off of Summer Street on the old railroad tracks. It loves railroad tracks, riverbeds, factories that are gone, you know, disturbed soils. So it's something that people really took it on hand. You can just take the rosettes off every year, and after 3 or 4 years, it'll be gone. That's one method of doing it. But again, it grows in real thick areas, thorns and other, you know, just pretty hard to get in there.
What's it recognize? What does it look like?
Oh, it looks like Queen Anne's lace about this tall.
Oh, it does.
It was pretty enough to pick, which people have done.
And the flower's real big. It's big as a dinner plate.
Yes, flower's about this big. It has a fern-like leaf. It's just a nasty plant that shouldn't be allowed to, propagate, especially on one of the most pristine freshwater tidal zones in the state.
But it sounds
it loves
like
waterways. If it gets into that system, then there's no stopping it.
Is it in the North River yet? Or not
yet? I haven't seen it. It's up and down Route 14. And they dug it up. They dug up the soil. They protected as much as they could, but they didn't get it all. I saw plants growing on the side. And I get kind of where I've done my thing. I had an approach to it. It would have worked. Got shut down. Now it's somebody else's problem. Might want to write to Conservation Commission, ask them what they're doing about it.
Is it identified so that if I was walking in that area, is it
gated to
say don't touch?
You should be walking. There's no signs. There's a fence they put up, and it should have pictures and signs, and at least people can know what it is and know what to stay away from.
Right.
So you could write Conservation and say, why don't you put up some signs? It'd be a nice thing to do.
Right.
No.
What about loose strife? I kind of like it.
Well, the only good loose strife is dead loose strife. It has no place.
Nobody eats the seeds in the fall?
No, and it's a tuber, and it's invasive. The only good thing is it grows on the surface. You can get it out. If you look at around Big Sandy, there's nothing but loosestrife now. I've watched it slowly migrate into areas from that area into Furnace Pond. It's starting to take over around the edges completely.
What's its natural inhibitor? I had this issue on my backyard, Mahogama, and they all marked at me and they ripped it up. But it never took over, but it just stayed in one little spot because there was enough competitive inhibition.
Go look around.
Except then when the man around the corner clear-cutted his yard, then he had all
drought year.
Was it a drought year?
When it's a drought year, the seeds totally take over.
Oh, so it spreads after a drought.
If you look around Big Sandy, it's a classic where they pull the water down so far that they've exposed all the river, the pond banking for at least 100 feet in many places.
Oh, so that's when it's prevalent.
And it's just a blanket.
But there's nothing else, no other grass that wants to grow there?
It's a mono plant. You will have just loosestrife in 10 years. There will be no other native plants. So I made Art and I did a meet and greet at the Abington Rockland Waterworks. We like to go and just, we go to all of Rockland, Abington, Rockland, all the waterworks people that are taking water from the town in different areas. And we meet and greet, and they're like, good, see you later. They want us out here too quick. Take a seat. And they come up with this plan they've had since 1964 that they're pushing all the permits through. They already have one pipe going to Rockland and Abington from Silver Lake, from Big Sandy. And it's an old pipe that's leaking. And they just upgraded their sewer system so they have 25% more water that they can take from somewhere because they're putting it back in over here in the Acura. Where do you think they're going to take that water from? Okay, so their plan is to put two pipes from Rockland to Abington, bigger pipes, and actually put them to the treatment center. But then Big Sandy is already drawn down. So we'll just want to pipe from it over to Furnace Pond and take direct out of Furnace Pond. And that second pipe, we're going to sell it to Brockton to make money.
One of our selectmen got involved in that? One of the Pembroke selectmen?
Billy Walter is running as a intermediate for Pembroke. He's a member of one of the boards in the Plymouth County Water District Commission. And we go to all the meetings, Art and I, and we have gotten a little bit of money set aside for a datum, which will tell us exactly where they can and can't take water. There is no real datum, so it's kind of like, yeah, there's a little brush mark on the wall over there, that's it. So we need to be knowing where the daydreams, where they can and cannot take water.
There's because no water law anywhere?
Daydream's a benchmark. On land, it's a benchmark. On water, it's a daydream. We don't have them.
But there's no laws anywhere that govern it? It's all like...
Oh, there are laws that govern it. The state owns the water, we don't. And that's it. The only reason we have any rights to that water now as far as controlling it is the herring are endangered, so these guys are doing a pretty good job at maintaining the height of the ponds, which we get yelled at for maintaining the height of the ponds. So it's a kind of no-win situation for some people, but it's only a few people get affected by the higher water. So it's an ongoing process, but if we don't dig your heels in deep and start, it's going to take Congress to really change this, because as a state, we just don't have the power to override the state. It's a state law. So we need Congress to come in at one point to lobby and to fix this. And I think we got Mrs. Cutler here. Election son, he's very active. He's a really good representation and works hard to help us with the water issues. He's done great things. Thank you.
Doesn't most of these towns have well water?
Well, why do they? They don't need it. They have so.
Well, I don't care that my well.
They have so like. Why would they want well water?
But I thought Pembroke and Marshfield have well water.
Yes, so we do because we can't take water from the reservoirs.
But I prefer well water. It's my field.
Well water is good. Again, the problem with well water, any taking of aquifers. Everybody lives on the coast, everybody lives around ponds. Silver Lake recharges 4 million gallons a day.
From the aquifer?
Recharges 4 million gallons. That's the facts. So let's take 10 out of it every day. Everybody knows it's going to go dry. And the aquifer underneath is going to eventually be depleted. So it's all happening. They've collapsed all the springs around these ponds. They've collapsed all the springs around Big Sandy. And once you collapse a spring, outside of an ice age, coming in, freezing the land, popping it up, and then running through it again, it doesn't ever come alive. So when we asked Rockland back up a bit, we were there to ask them what they were going to do about all of the invasive species around Big Sandy, blue stripe, number one. And they said, well, what could you do? I said, well, you could plant North Atlantic cedar trees, and that would eventually shade it out and put back the sphagnum moss and maybe start building springs back. They were very happy to say, oh, yeah, let's do that. Because it made them look good. So, didn't take them up on it. It's a nice idea, but I'm not going to help somebody with a fix instead of them stop taking so much water, let the water come back up, plant some trees along the edge, and drown the loosestrife. That's never going to happen.
But that's the purple loosestrife. Yellow is native?
Yellow loosestrife?
There's yellow loosestrife, ladies. I know there is.
I didn't know that.
Yes, there is, and it's not invasive.
So that's when you put in your garden.
I was told it was native.
Well, I'll look that up. I'll ask you if it's my dad or something.
There was some in my backyard in Hamama.
So we have these water bans.
I would see people with a garden hose running at 5 in the morning, just watering a rock. Running across the barren ground, running down the street into the catch basin. And I drove back by an hour later, person still out with no garden, and with just a running hose, watering a rock and crabgrass. And it's just running down into the sewer. And I don't see any, you know, water police out there.
Yeah, who does enforce that?
There are agencies that do.
But we're down. I mean, I saw it in Marshfield.
But it pretty much has to be somebody. They're not going to drive around and catch many people. It has to be somebody saying, hey, you know.
Well, it's the sprinklers, because there's not supposed to be any automatic sprinklers. So then the neighbors just put them off at night.
It was hand watering, but a rock.
Yeah, the water.
But even the sprinklers, they were abusing, because they were putting the automatic.
You know, Rockland says to us, well, Pembroke doesn't have a water ban. Why should we? It's simple, you won't go around Pembroke. And when we do have our little water dam, you won't find people sprinkling, you won't find people doing much. You know, we all have common sense that we know the water pressures. And Pembroke's pretty good stewards of somebody else's resource. I wish they were as good stewards back to us. Water is the biggest threat to this community of a lack of in the future. And 138 years of free water. I really don't understand why we shouldn't get something so we could at least remediate the damages that they cause. And one way to get money from them is to bring them to court for the damages and get remediation. There is 1964, the federal government stepped off, the state took over the water, and when they did that, they decommissioned most of the remediation officers. That in 100-some-odd years, they didn't remediate a cent worth of damage, and they put their kids through college on the funds they got.
Well, look, one thing that scared me, like even with Scituate, every summer, the reservoir would be like barren, you know, like you see the rocks, and like all this development is still going on, and I'm just like...
They do have a moratorium on development on condos in certain areas, but they were smart enough to know it was coming, and all the condos on Driftway built got grandfathered real quick, just before they did.
And, I mean, it's just scary.
What Pembroke is going to need in the future is sewage. Everybody lives around the ponds, and if you go into the rivers, you'll see this blue, this green algae, like hair. In a clean system, you'll see it on the rocks, but you won't see it stranding off everywhere and floating. All that algae you see in the ponds floating, and that is all due to nitrates and phosphates from sewer systems.
We have the same problem in Halifax. The west,
yes.
One ponds, it
has
been really bad.
And eventually, they draw down enough water, they pull the aquifer from underneath. Right now, I study the water flow, and I'm not scientifically doing it, but just using a very educated person. And right now, we're getting 2.5 million gallons a day from Oldham to Furnace. And if you go down to the back of Furnace, we're getting 1 million. So there's 2.5 million coming in by the barbershop. And at the end of the dam, where it goes out, without Brockton pulling, we're losing 1.5 million gallons right now.
Where's it going?
What pond is 100 feet from?
I don't know. I'm not good at that.
Big Sandy.
Oh, it's going to the other pond.
There's a causeway 100 feet wide. Art did some drone footage on a helicopter, and you can see the iron coming right in like a big plume, right under the causeway and pluming right into Big Sandy. So they're pulling the aquifer completely out from underneath Furnace Pond. That's why Oldham Pond is relatively clean. When Furnace Pond turns green like a swamp, that is not Brockton, that is Abington Rockland Waterworks doing that, in my opinion, which I have plenty of in high school diploma, but lots of field experiments.
Wow.
So, I mean, you can see it happen, and if somebody was to put in dye packs, dig holes, put the dye packs
right,
in,
right.
And, you know, put the radioactive isotope dye packs, it would be a matter of hours before they would show the pond.
Wow.
And prove this once and for all. They are totally draining Furnace from the bottom. It changes the temperature, it causes algae blooms, it causes blue-green algae. These are very complex problems for the future of Pembroke. We did the development every 15 years. They come through with this bunch of students and they do a development plan for Pembroke. Their top priority was sewerage and scarcity of water in the future.
Yeah.
The Pembroke's biggest problem is facing the water glut of not only our own town, because we'll have to ratchet down a bit, but feeding Brockton and 9 other communities for free not getting that dime back from remediation, when remediation is the only thing we can get back. You can't bill them for the water, but you can get environmentally damaged money. That's where you have to go.
I need to know who you report to. What I mean by that is you
have
an awful lot of information.
Who
is in the town? You work for the town of Pembroke?
No, I don't work. I'm a volunteer.
You're a volunteer.
Absolutely across the board, yeah.
Okay, so you're a volunteer person.
In fisheries, I report to my one of two bosses. Mark Amarillo is the head of the fisheries. And then we have a backup, which is Billy. He's an auxiliary. And we team up with two people to do all things we do. So it's two people for safety reasons. And other than that, when I have a real problem, I bring it to the proper authorities, whether it be the North River Commission for, say, cutting of trees illegally. You could have brought that to DEP and they would prosecute, so you could kind of go the lesser route and try to get it taken care of. And then when you're stumbling around that place and go downstream at West Elm Street, and there's five cesspits the size of this room from a rubber mill. There's nothing growing on them. You stick a stick in them, it goes down 2 feet and pulls out this cup that you definitely don't even want to touch. You bounce around on it, you think it's the moonwalk is when you're a kid. Then you realize, well, it's not a good thing. So, after being told it was out of my jurisdiction, when I reported it to one person, I was told to put it in a different location, which nothing happened there. And then the North River Commission said, well, maybe we'll stumble across it when we're looking at this. I stumbled across it. You were just told about these cesspits. They've been there since 1800. So finally, after all things failed, I called the DEP and started a file number, which we're still trying to get going. Because it runs one to another, and then a gaping hole in it, 7 feet wide, 5 feet deep, just runs right into the river. And that river has the last of two spawning shad ones in the state. So that's why I'm a little particular about it.
And so she grew up West Elm.
So I was one of those little kids in the early 50s that I lived in the big house next to the rubber mill.
There you go. Mm-hmm.
So I know the holes and the rubber, and so that's what it was. It was rubber mill.
And what are rubber mills famous for?
It was for the anchor.
What is rubber famous for?
Oil.
And what is oil? Once man gets his hands on it, what's the chemical we produce? PCBs. Man-made PCBs by refining oils and rubber. So you have refined oil and rubber. You have heat, you have PCBs. So I'm hoping I'm incorrect on this, but I don't feel I am. Since nothing grows on those things, not even a skunk cabbage, which can take as much acid as it's own person. So, I may or may not have been within my jurisdiction, but as a person, an individual, I did that. I want just disclaimer. Anything I said to the DEP and to other agencies was strictly as an individual, not a representation to the town. Absolutely. It's just something that's been there, needs to be looked at. Hopefully I'm wrong. But if not, then you have a nightmare.
When did you do this?
I started on it 2 years ago.
Oh.
I finally gave it up and did it myself as a citizen 6 months ago. Just didn't go anywhere. It just couldn't get it above the flagpole. And I know it's not my jurisdiction because as a conservation commissioner, I'm told it's the land under the water, the land abutting the water, to the top of the mountain. And all the trees and habitats and individuals and flora and fauna that grow within it. So I don't know why it wouldn't be jurisdiction. So I disagree. But I think it needs to be looked at, and hopefully it will be. and I don't get too many rocks on my house.
Another question for you. I just got permission from the town a couple months ago to cut down some trees that are dying from, I don't know if they're termites, but it's kind of a bug that. Anyway, what should I plant in its place? I'm near the lake, East Monponset.
What is the tree? What was it?
I think they're old birch, but they don't have the birch bark. I can't tell.
There's black birch.
Oh, maybe it's black birch. It could be black birch.
So it's a dark, flat, smooth skin?
Yeah, relatively smooth skin. Yeah.
I would plant the birch back there. The white birch, it's too hot for them here.
Okay.
And that's why they have all the, without enough snow to blow off the insect lava that lay the eggs and all the egg casings on them.
Mm-hmm.
Like up north, they're white because they're snowblown. Mm-hmm. And all the egg casings get blown up.
Mm-hmm.
Down here, it's not hot enough. I mean, it's too hot and they grow. And if you have a birch tree, unless it's an ornamental, then they can handle it. They go straight up and they're a very big tree,
mm-hmm.
European.
Mm-hmm.
But the native birch, best thing to do is recut them every so many years and they rejuvenate off a node. It has a root and above it, a big node.
Mm-hmm.
It has trees on it, hundreds of it, thousands of it.
Oh,
so when you cut a birch tree, you get a true tree back, not a sucker.
Hmm.
The only tree that happens at them. So you can recut them and rejuvenate them back and you get nice groups. You get old, cut them again, you get more.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
But as far as planting, anything native.
Okay.
If you're near the water, North Atlantic feet cedars. They're a beautiful tree. They have a funny way of surviving in the winters where a lot of things want to eat them because they've got a lot of oil and nutrients and they're tender. So they grow up and they have like a spaghetti top, and as soon as it gets snow, it goes right down to the ground like a shoe horseshoe and buries the top in the snow. So in the spring, it comes right back up, uneaten, and stands up.
Mm-hmm.
Trees have very unique ways of adapting.
Mm-hmm.
The seeds from North Atlantic cedars will gather in the ground cover for 15 years. It'll just keep coming down. And then say the beaver dam breaks and they germinate all at once,
mm-hmm.
and form a forest. And they lock the roots together and then they grow really straight and some get shaded up and most don't. They grow. The interesting thing that the vole does, the vole has a reason to be. Until I learned this, I was a downright vole hater. But their little burrows and their scat, their droppings, create fungal rhizomes that germinate the fir and the North Atlantic seeds. And that's why in a beaver meadow, the right trees can back the firs and grow because of the little vole. So, you have to like him for what he does good, tolerate what he doesn't do.
Well, thanks, Rick. Let's have refreshments so we can get out on time.
Okay. If anyone wants to take my phone number, if you have any questions later on.
Okay.
You can take my phone number.
Good.
Go.
781. 784. Right there.
738-3444.